Расскажите нам, пожалуйста, все-таки, что с вашей
Please
точки
tell us
зрения
what you think is happening in Kazakhstan at the moment. Why did charges against you follow charges against Viktor Vyacheslavovich? What is the story behind these accusations?
В том числе появились обвинения против вас, Лева Колебекова.
За недостаточностью.
We learned from the media that Swiss authorities turned down the Kazakh request for extradition.
Казахстанской власти.
Это все происходит.
In other words, they never passed any charges against you personally. Is this happening behind your back?
Ну, для меня вообще-то как бы.
For me, these emotions and this desire to flex their muscles are easy to understand. Kazakh authorities need to demonstrate to the entire country their ability to exert influence abroad, how they are able to punish those they find objectionable to the regime. So we assume something of the sort may be awaiting us. We knew it was being done in secret to make it a surprise and that we would not be informed. Therefore, we found out everything from the media.
А может быть, вот это новый поворот во всей этой истории связан с...
Maybe this new twist in the entire story is due to the assumption that you are more prone to charges and requests of extraditions as opposed to Viktor Vyacheslavovich.
Традиции там и так далее, по сравнению с Виктором Вячеславовичем.
Я думаю, что если бы власть думала...
I think if the authorities had the capacity to think, they would not be attempting what they are now. Starting with the case of Rahat Aliyev, the actions carried out by the authorities were unsightly and discrediting for the image of the country. We were still living in Kazakhstan when it astonished me that a simple family dispute acquired such international resonance. Thus, when it comes to us, the scenario is repeating itself. There is a will to punish and to do harm. The authorities used administrative resources, time, money, and staff members, all of the above to satisfy one person's whims, you know whose, obviously. I think everyone here in Europe clearly understands there is no reason behind this. I do not know why it is being done. It completely ricocheted. All we have left to do is observe how the events unravel, much like yourselves.
Значит, что власть предпринимает и как события развиваются. Мы просто, нам остается, как и вам, наблюдать за всем этим.
Это же свойственно для подобного рода таких вот.
Do you think that even in this critical field of government, someone is attempting to show the results of their work? It is common in authoritarian regimes for officials to demonstrate how hard they are toiling, so these accusations and demands crop up. But the fact that it looks silly and awkward afar doesn't concern anyone.
Неуклюже, нелепо, я бы даже сказал. В общем, мало кто волнуется.
Если ответить на ваш вопрос.
Certainly, this is harmful to the president because a critical mass is gaining weight over time. But the question I would like to ask is. As a businesswoman in Kazakhstan since 1990, I was unable to earn enough for a decent living. As it stands, much better management skills were demonstrated by Dariga Nazarbayeva, Dinara Kulibayeva, Aliya Nazarbayeva, as well as the grandson Nurali. Almost the entire national leader's family entered Kazakhstan's Forbes list. If I am demanded to present my sources of revenue, then I am all for it. I have already done so with Swiss authorities. I try to be as transparent as possible. As for my demands, I would like the Nazarbayev family to do the same. Show all their sources of revenue. It is not that hard to do these days. To answer your question, if they want to construct their arguments to charge Viktor Vyacheslavovich based on my activity, then let them, if they have nothing else to spend money on. We will be acting within the law of the land in which we are legally residing. We have legally crossed the Kazakh border, arrived in Switzerland in 2007, and received an official residence permit.
Viktor Vyacheslavovich, coming from the highest ranks, you know firsthand how the state machine operates. Could you try and go over every minute detail of how the decision-making process by the authorities operated in this court case in order for us to evaluate it?
Alexei, judging by what is going on in Kazakhstan based on media reports, I understand the head of state ordered law enforcement officials to find any incriminating evidence against my wife Leyla Khrapunova and do all in their powers to impose sanctions upon the both of us.
Do you think this new wording by Akarda pitting you along with an organized criminal group would be able to influence the actions of Swiss law enforcement authorities or not? What are they hoping for?
I think Akorda is not hoping for anything. They want to do as much harm as possible. There is no other way to describe it. They are counting on a certain level of support. They may have their own lawyers here, hire a private detective. They think they will somehow be able to be convincing, having secured someone's support to freeze my bank accounts at this initial stage. Obviously, Swiss authorities will sooner or later deal with the matter. I am convinced they, along with Kazakh Special Services, know for a fact that the money we have been incriminated with for several years does not exist and never has, so they are simply staging a game. You were correct in saying that the bureaucracy is interested in this. Why? First, trips abroad paid for by the state budget. After all, Switzerland is not one of the poorest states to visit. We witnessed a certain revitalization around us in the last couple of years. I am happy for those officials who can claim they are doing real work and justify these expenses. As for us, I think it only emboldens us, keeps us in shape, and I think we just need to maintain it by performing our civic duty. I see a certain mission in this.
Распущенность, вот какая, такая политическая вот коррупция.
Вот вы сейчас упомянули.
You just mentioned the so-called revenge factor. In connection to that, around the same time as your Layla website appeared on the internet, a bugged conversation between Viktor Harpunov and Aslan Musin was leaked, after which Musin left the post of President's chief of staff. Do you think the revenge factor has something to do with this? Are the two events connected?
Произвёлся такой взрыв, прослушка.
I can say one thing, Alexei. All law enforcement agencies in Kazakhstan are so supportive of one another that the slightest comment regarding one agency momentarily echoes around the chambers of all of them, literally. And you observed correctly that this is the President of the Republic of Kazakhstan regime's reaction to what took place on air and in the papers. Although this is free speech, it is something that is being proven the world over. We need to fight for in every country so that human rights are observed and there is freedom of speech. In this situation, the website that Layla published and demonstrated in detail her work history and her income, as well as raised capital, which all of a sudden became an object of overt attention regarding the activities that Layla performed in Kazakhstan. Therefore, I do not rule out that the bugged conversation may have tipped the scale and led Aslan Musin to switch workplaces, but the immediate reaction that followed was against those who dared disturb the established system of counterbalance in the Republic of Kazakhstan.
Within the general theory of escalating political events in Kazakhstan, I'm forced to ask, how far is this escalation able to reach? The reason I ask is because, judging by the experience of the 1930s, we saw fantastic, unbelievable formulations. We're witnessing their taking root in new legislative terms such as family criminal group, which sounds really threatening, not from the standpoint of what the term means, but who comes up with it.
Alexei, since you mentioned the topic of repressions, if we look back to 1937, the formulation was as follows. Enemy of the state, wife of the enemy of the state, children of the enemy of the state. Here we are witnessing a certain modernization through combining these terms, an evolution of dictatorial regimes. Times are changing, dictators are changing, their styles of repression are changing as well. This is how I see it. Nowadays, it is a personal enemy of the national leader, but it is hard to use the enemy of the state formulation against us in times of peace. It is easier to claim we have committed some vague crime. The regime wants more blood. I was told personally that we would be hit so hard, including our children, that we would all be writhing with pain. Thus, a legislative amendment is ordered to create a family group under which, just like in the repressive 1937, his entire family, close relatives, children are being persecuted with the use of modern technology. Why not? Incidentally, if we cite one of the interviews conducted by your channel with Gary Kasparov, he put it quite well, saying, our times are characterized by dictators who want to rule like Stalin, but live pompously and affluently like Rockefeller, flying in private jets and owning private yachts. In the meantime, we must take it as a norm. Their children are officially on the Forbes list of billionaires, having barely been born yet. Meanwhile, hardworking individuals acting within what seemed like a guaranteed constitutional framework in a market economy, within legal means, observing all norms and laws, all of a sudden, with the passing of time and at the whims of one person, become members of an organized criminal group.
Maybe the regime lost its confidence in being able to reach an agreement with you, leading it to wholeheartedly attempt a form of persecution as part of general pressure exerted over you. By the way, are you in any way under pressure?
Вообще осуществляется ли на вас сейчас какое-то давление?
Indeed, we have been pressed for 5 years. We are subjected to material damages. My business in Kazakhstan suffered while we were still living there. In particular, I was shocked to learn from the Swiss press about Dunato Kolibayev's purchase of a villa in Anyers, near Geneva, for almost 75 million francs without loans or mortgages. A journalist investigation was conducted immediately, since information about real estate deals are in the public domain. The Swiss real estate market exploded when Dunato Kolibayev's name appeared in the registry, and journalists could not pass the story by. I was not among the first to find out about the purchase from the press. What surprised me was that along with her Swiss residence permit, it turned out Dinara was an economist, an executive of Villette Company. As a side note, the word Villette is an acronym consisting of the first names of my entire family, Victor, Ilyas, Leila, Elvira, and Daniel. As a small or medium-scale business, it is normal for an entrepreneur to do that. When the name of my jewelry company that was forcibly purchased from me in Kazakhstan by a company affiliated with Timur Kulibayev appeared in the Swiss press, it was a revelation to me that she served as an executive. I did some research on the internet and found out about the yearly sales of this and other companies that were criminally taken from me in 2003 for next to nothing. At the time, an entire negative PR campaign unraveled against Viktor Vyacheslavovich in the press belonging to Timur Kulibayev. This residence permit held by Dinara Kulibayeva indicating my company as her place of employment is an indisputable fact. You ask me if I feel confident. I do feel confident that the longer this investigation continues, the more facts of this kind will be revealed. I assume Dinara Kulibayeva is above the law on organized criminal groups. Being born in 1963, she is much younger than I am. But unlike me, she was able to somehow generate wealth independently from her father, the president of Kazakhstan. Unlike me, she can afford a villa in Anyer and claim to have earned it through honest hard work. I think the debate would be interesting. Therefore, I do not understand the Kazakh authorities' logic, what they are pursuing and counting on. In any case, since we are official residents of the Swiss Confederacy, I believe if there are court cases, they will be held on the territory of Switzerland. Here, unlike in Kazanauzian in western Kazakhstan, we will be able to protect ourselves, speak the truth, and be confident that our rights will be observed, unlike the rights of Kazakh citizens.
I'm experiencing a deja vu dating back to when an attempt to persecute the former PM, Kazhegeldin, and a search for the famous million ended in Kazakhgate. Now we're seeing a similar situation when the president's family is attempting to accuse you. All the while, the names of companies comprising members of the family began cropping up. Why do you think they needed to start persecuting you in Switzerland, considering the fact that they will have a lot to explain in terms of what, why, and how they were acquired?
Собственности в данном случае уже.
Ну вот, конечно.
Kazakhgate was a lesson lost on them. They are stepping on the same rakes again by freezing Timur Kulibayev's accounts in Switzerland with his notoriously smuggled $600 million. From what I have heard and read in the press, the process is ongoing. Moreover, another issue that is often raised here is the $100 million in the name of Saulia Driblesova. This is the amount that was earned in the sale of the state television and radio station. Rumors spread across the small town of Geneva that investigators began over President Karimov's daughter's bank accounts, with some of them being frozen. The Swiss justice system did the smart thing and froze the accounts of all of Uzbekistan's high-ranking officials. Nowadays, there are talks in Switzerland that since the financial police's activities against my family are gaining traction, the same may take place here. I was told by a Swiss official at one of our meetings that we may be expecting all Kazakh bank accounts to be blocked in Switzerland. However, I witnessed a conversation where it was mentioned that the Nazarbayev family has already taken its money out from Switzerland to other nations. Thus, the financial police was ordered to act freely and without hesitation. We can construct various theories, but we will be observing the course of events just like you are, since we are not being informed at all, and everything is taking place behind our backs. We believe the actions are so emotionally charged, spontaneous, and poorly thought out, that it seems like a silly game, or that they no longer care. In general, the fact that in the end I suffered for exercising my right to free speech and was placed on the wanted list on the financial police website, and on October 1st I was placed on Interpol's international wanted list, forces me to laugh instead of getting upset. You mentioned Kazakhgate, but if you recall, the first to be placed on Interpol's international wanted list by the Swiss authorities was the Nazarbayev, Kulibayev and Smakhambetov families, so I am in good company.
Yes, but the escalation of events alarms me because I inevitably draw parallels with the 1930s when trials, persecutions and repressions began with people distant from the Communist Party, followed by those who were at one point or another directly involved, notwithstanding the degree of their guilt or what led to the detention. In the end, an entire mess was made, indicating the regime's inefficiency. What we see now is confusion, disordered movement. Does this speak of the nature and the evolution of the authorities in Kazakhstan? Viktor Vyacheslavovich, what do you think?
You're absolutely correct in drawing these parallels. Going deeper into the subject, there was a case of doctors in the 1930s. It was replicated in Kazakhstan with the imprisonment of the Minister of Health. In the USSR, there was a case of judges. It was replicated in Kazakhstan. Only times, layouts, faces, and dictators change. There is some kind of evolutionary development, and you noted correctly that new methods of repression are being discovered with manhunts, international searches. Back in the Soviet Union, there were no wanted lists. Men were sent straight to Vorkuta, women to to Kazakhstan, namely Alzhir, an acronym that stands for Akulin's Camp for Wives of Traders. Children went to specialized orphanages for children of traders. The situation in Kazakhstan is somewhat similar. Take a look at how many lives were broken, all because of trumped-up cases, which are growing and growing in number. I recall the trial over Kazhegeldin. Even his lawyer was really representing the interests of the regime. The same is happening with us. Nobody approached us officially. Nobody told us about charges pressed against us. There is no official investigation. We only found out about it through mass media reports. If they wanted to, they could interrogate us. Perhaps the regime is scared of something, although I do not know what. Ladle noted correctly. There is an interested party, President of the Republic of Kazakhstan. He invited law enforcement officials and gave them a direct order. By all means necessary, work out all the details and bring back Trapunov to Kazakhstan, and we will deal with him here. How will they frame the case and how are they going to go about this is their own business. Therefore, there is no point of mentioning social justice or impartiality in Kazakhstan. As you said, the analogy between modern Kazakhstan and the Soviet Union is seen here with our own eyes.
Спасибо вам большое за очень интересное.
Thank you both for a very interesting interview. I hope we will keep our viewers informed of the latest events. Thank you.
Я имею в виду прежде всего со стороны Казахстана. Спасибо вам огромное.
Thank you, Алексей.